Monica Dalrielle, and I'm an environmental scientist with American Construction Point, and I'll be the moderator for tonight's hearing. Before getting started, I would like to remind everyone to please sign in on the sign-in sheet of the registration table, just to make sure that we have an accurate number of individuals who are here, and it will also make sure you're added to the mailing list for this project. This is a formal public hearing for the proposed Veterans Way Phase 2 project that extends between Smith Road and State Road 3. Because this project is receiving federal funding, the Indiana Department of Transportation must review the project to ensure that it is consistent with design standards and has adequate public involvement. Just a reminder that everything you see here tonight is still in the preliminary phases of development. This means that no final decisions have been made on the project. Okay, so the agenda for tonight's hearing consists of a formal presentation, which we are doing now, and this will include the description of the intent and format of the hearing, the project description, including maintenance of traffic, anticipated right-of-way, and estimated project costs by Mr. Patrick Wooden, who is the project manager for American Construction Point. After this, I will return for a summary of the environmental and land acquisition process. This will be followed by a period of time where you, the public, are offered the opportunity to publicly make a comment regarding this project. Should you desire to make a public statement, there's a sign-in sheet back on that registration table. And following the conclusion of this formal portion of the hearing, the project team will be available to answer any questions you may have. We have prepared an information packet for you today, which hopefully you all picked up on that back table. And this has many of the details that we'll be going over tonight. Copies of this information packet, you can take some more if there, you know someone who is not available to make it to the hearing tonight. You can also email us if you missed one, and we'll make sure that a copy is provided to you. So, with me here tonight from American Structure Point, I have Mr. Patrick Wooden, and he is the project manager. There's also Mr. Tanner McKinney, who is a staff engineer on this project. And to assist me with this facilitation, I have Mr. Chad Costa, back at the registration table. In addition, Ms. Skip Tenecor and Kelly Dean, who are both land acquisition specialists. And then Mr. Joe Gromoski, who's also back there, and he's a relocation agent. So following the public comment session, we will all be available over at those side tables to answer any questions about the project. This project is sponsored by the City of Greensburg, and I would like to introduce some of the representatives of the city who are here tonight. We have Mr. Ron May, who is the city engineer, Mr. Mark Klosterkemper, the street commissioner. The city's redevelopment commission has also been heavily involved with the development of this project. We would like to extend an opportunity for any other elected officials who may be present here this evening to stand up and be recognized. So at this time, you can stand up and state your name and position held. All right. So as I mentioned earlier, this project is reviewed by the Indiana Department of Transportation. So at this time, I would like to introduce Ms. Mary Ray, and she is the hearing examiner for the Indiana Department of Transportation. Okay. The intent of this hearing is twofold. First, it is intended to explain the proposed project and receive your comments, concerns, and suggestions. Second, it is a requirement of the National Environmental Policy Act that the public be afforded the opportunity to be involved in the decision-making process. This includes accepting comments on the environmental document and the preliminary plans. For this project, this hearing is a continuation of the public involvement process that really started over a year ago, when we held a public information meeting at the same location back on May 5th, 2016. After continued project development, we sought the input of residents from Edgewater and Lake Point apartment complexes through the distribution of a survey. Now it's intended to gain understanding on community cohesion, the use of green space, and potential impacts and burdens to those communities. After this, we had an open house on December 19, 2016, and this was for the residents of those two apartment complexes to learn more about the project. The difference with this meeting here tonight is that it's a more formal setting where you're able to voice your comments in front of an audience if you so desire. So a formal notice for this meeting was advertised in the May 9th and May 16th editions of the Greensburg Daily News. Also, direct mailings were sent to adjacent property owners and every apartment at Edgewater and Lake Point apartment complexes. This is a courtesy that we provide, and sometimes our mailing lists are not up to date. So if you did not receive the mailing and you want to be on the mailing list, make sure that you sign in on that back table and we'll make sure that you get future notices. So the preliminary plans and the environmental document prepared for this project were available for public inspection beginning on May 9th, both here at the City Engineer's Office and at the American Structure Point Office. These documents will remain open for public inspection following this hearing and through the end of the comment period, which is June 7th. These documents are also located on the side tables here if you want to look at them after this. So there are several ways that you can provide comments, and these are outlined in your information packet on the first page. If you'd like to make a comment tonight, you can make a formal public statement after this presentation. Again, the sign-in sheet is on the back table, and your comments will all be recorded by our court reporter. If you'd rather not make a public statement, then anytime after this presentation and the public statements are made, you can make an individual comment with the court reporter, and be assured that these comments will also be a part of the transcription and be given full consideration. Another option is that you can write down your comment. So there's a comment sheet in the back of your information packet, and you can just return these. There's a box on the back table, or you can give it to any of the representatives here tonight. If you want to leave a comment, not tonight, but after this hearing, then you can submit a comment via mail, fax, email, and the contact information is all in your information packet. And there will also be a slide at the end that has the contact information. And if you do submit a comment via email, I'll be sure to give a reply acknowledging that your comment has been received. So all of the comments that are submitted tonight and in the 2 weeks following this presentation will be part of the public official record for this project. Please remember, if you mail your comments, they must be postmarked no later than June 7th to make sure that they become part of the official record. This is also the deadline for any email or faxed comments. So remember, June 7th for all comments. All right. So should you desire to make a public statement, please sign in at the sheet in the back, and all persons signing up to speak will be asked to come up to the podium in the order that you signed up, clearly state your first and last name, and then begin your comment. And this is just to assure the court reporter correctly identifies who is making the comment and the nature of your comment. In the interest of time and respect for others, we ask that you limit your comments to 2 to 3 minutes. After everyone who signed up to speak has been given an opportunity to come forward, I will re-offer the opportunity and you can come forward and continue your comment or make an additional comment. Please know that we do want to and will formally respond to all of your comments. However, with respect for others' time that can be overlooked if we have lengthy back and forth discussions, all responses will be in writing as part of the environmental document. A public notice of availability will be advertised in the same media sources as was for the notice of this hearing. So if you want to make sure you get a notice, please sign up on the back table and that way we'll ensure it is mailed to you.
Thanks,
following the conclusion of the public comment session, the formal portion of the hearing will be adjourned. The project team will still be able to answer any questions, but just remember that all discussions after the formal presentation will not be part of the official project record. And now, I will turn it over to Mr. Patrick Wood.
Thank you, Monica. Can everybody hear me okay? go through a brief project description and discuss some of the alternatives that we've looked at as part of the engineering study here at the start of the project development. And I want to start by going through the purpose and need of the project. The primary need that's been identified by the city of Greenfield is to spur economic development within the TIF district, which is bounded on the south side of I-74 between US 421 and State Road 3. As part of that, there needs to be infrastructure that can access the developable land along that's within the TIF district. The existing roadway network is problematic for providing this access, primarily due to tight turns and narrow roadways along the existing roadways that are available within this portion of the corridor. So the first part, the Veterans Way Phase 1 project, partially addressed this access issue by providing access to US 421. This was identified in the city's comprehensive plan. As part of this Phase 2 project, we're intending to provide access to State Road 3. This would complete the plan to provide that connectivity throughout the TIF district. Another need of the project that's been identified is project safety, and specifically it's the safety of all users of the corridor, including drivers, pedestrians, and non-vehicular users of the corridor. We want to address the lack of connectivity between existing non-vehicular facilities that are on either side of the project limits. So some of the alternatives that we considered as part of addressing the purpose and need of the project, three primary alternates were identified to achieve this access to State Road 3, and these are in the existing intersections along 3 with Freeland Road, Lincoln Street, and Broadway Street. Each of these options would provide access to the developable land further west of the project limits within Phase 1. Each of these options would also impact existing development to various degrees. The Broadway option, which is shown in green on the exhibit behind me, is most similar to the existing roadway network in that it follows the existing roadways of Broadway and Smith. However, this alternate would have the greatest impact on existing developments, including home and business relocations along Smith Road and Broadway. It is also the least beneficial in terms of potential development within the Phase 2 portion of the project corridor. The Freeland Road option, which is shown in red on the exhibit behind me, would have some traffic operational issues at the intersection of State Road 3 due to how close it is to the interstate ramps at I-74. By introducing that much traffic so near to the interstate ramps, there'd be some operational issues, there could be some traffic backups with that as an option. The Lincoln Street option, which is shown in blue, it does address the development issues that were identified in alternate one, alternate A, and it also improves on the operational issues identified in alternate C. Alternate B also does provide a direct access point to connect the TIF district to the downtown central business district via the access along Lincoln Street. For these reasons, we have identified alternate B as the recommended option. We did consider a do-nothing alternate as part of the evaluation. However, this alternate was rejected for failing to address the purpose and need of the project. As we noted, the existing roadway network is not really conducive to accessing the developable land because of the tight turns and narrow roadway along these existing networks. Therefore, this option of do-nothing was not pursued further. So with that as a background, here are some details concerning the proposed typical section along the Veterans Way Phase 2 project. This typical section is very similar to the Veterans Way Phase 1 project. So if you're familiar with the area, the Phase 1 project is very similar to what we're looking at here. There will be a single travel lane in each direction, and these travel lanes will be separated by a buffer. Curb and gutter will be alongside the roadway. Storm sewer will be installed as part of the project, and new roadway corridor lighting will be installed. The median where we have it is going to be a raised curb median. However, turn lanes are going to be provided in place of that raised median as necessary at driveways or at intersections through the corridor. So in those sections, when you get to an intersection, it will be a three-lane section with a single travel lane in each direction, but then a middle left turning lane in between those three travel lanes. Be aware that there is a reduced footprint proposed as the corridor gets closer to State Road 3. This is in order to minimize impacts along the corridor. So in this section, we'll be looking at a narrower travel lanes and a slower speed limit. A partial signal modification is going to be proposed at the State Road 3 Lincoln Street intersection in order to accommodate the additional traffic coming along the Veterans Way corridor. In addition, there's going to be a pedestrian crossing installed at State Road 3. So a multi-use path is going to be installed along the whole stretch of Phase 2 Veterans Way, and then that multi-use path is going to cross. There is going to be a crossing at State Road 3 with a pedestrian actuated signal to get across that intersection. And then there's some incidental construction proposed along Lincoln Street to extend the sidewalk along Lincoln Street to provide full connectivity between Phase 1 corridor limit and the existing sidewalks along Lincoln Street. So this is a graphical representation of the typical section. We have the same exhibits, if you want a closer view, over here on the side where we can talk informally following the formal presentation. This is a representation of the western portion of the corridor with the 14-foot travel lanes and the raised curb median. If you have any questions about that, we'll be happy to answer those as we move forward. This is a plan view, overhead view, exhibit. It's a graphical representation of what the recommended alternate would look like in the proposed alternate B. As you note, we're starting on the west side. This will be at Smith Road, and we're going to work our way to the east with this exhibit. The first thing is you see the curvature of the roadway as it ties in at Phase 1 limits. The roadway alignment has been set to avoid impacts to the overhead electric transmission lines that are out there today. I would also note there's a building impact in the southwest corner at the Broadway Street, the newly constructed, newly configured intersection at Broadway Street at the Edgewater Apartments. This is the leasing office for Edgewater Apartments. There would be building impacts to this leasing office with part of these building improvements. Continuing on to the east end, past Broadway. This layout is looking to avoid building impacts to both the Tractor Supply building and the Main Source building as we approach State Road 3. There's also a mid-block pedestrian crossing proposed in between these businesses. There is a building impact noted in the farm field. An agricultural outstructure that would be impacted by this proposed alignment. And then as we talk, there is a proposed pedestrian bicycle crossing along State Road 3 as part of the proposed improvements. And then sidewalk construction and incidental construction along Lincoln Street as part of the project as well. Most of this project is going to be built on new alignment. And as such, there should be minimal impacts on the existing roads during construction. However, we do have a number of crossings along the corridor at Broadway and at a tie-in at State Road 3. So there will be temporary impacts as part of the project at these locations as construction does move forward. We are anticipating maintaining access on these existing roadways during construction. However, there will be temporary lane restrictions as the project continues through these intersections and adjacent to these intersections. At the business district along State Road 3, we anticipate phased construction in this location in order to be able to maintain access to the businesses along State Road 3. We anticipate being able to keep the intersection on the west leg of Lincoln Street open and having access to the businesses and the users of those businesses during construction. It needs to be noted that for southbound traffic along State Road 3 that would want to make a right turn into the business district, there will be a time at the construction of that intersection when that movement will have to be restricted. It's just too tight a turn to be able to make that during construction and get the intersection built. So for a time, we would anticipate a temporary detour route for that specific southbound right turn movement during construction. Detour would follow along the existing roadway networks. Access will be maintained at all times to all the businesses and residents along the corridor. Because the project is on new alignment, new permanent land acquisition is anticipated with the recommended alternate. On the screen behind me are the estimates of the areas for both permanent and temporary land acquisition as part of the project. We anticipate 8 parcels along the corridor would be affected by this acquisition. I do want to say that temporary land acquisition is for land that is only to be acquired for the duration of the construction period. Once construction is complete, this temporary area would revert back to the original owner. Temporary right-of-way is going to be for things like driveway construction along the corridor and things of that nature, where just for purposes of constructing it to tie into the new roadway. Once that occurs, on the completion of the project, the temporary right-of-way would be reverted back to the original owner. The proposed easement that is listed up there is a drainage easement. This is on the east side of Broadway Street. And this easement is in order to maintain the existing drainage patterns along the corridor. The project costs that are listed here are what are shown on the State Transportation Improvement Program. They do include preliminary engineering, design, and environmental investigation services, what we're doing now, anticipated land acquisition costs, and anticipated construction costs. Funding for the project is through a combination of federal and local funding sources. The local funding is through the Greensburg Redevelopment Commission. The project is still in the preliminary design and environmental investigation stage. Once the stage is complete, the project will then move forward into a land acquisition phase. The process for the land acquisition, Monica is going to come back up here and discuss that here in a few minutes. But we do anticipate that land acquisition process will begin this coming fall, 2017. Once the land acquisition process is complete, we will then move forward with final design and plans on the project. And the project will be publicly bid for construction, following the state and federal requirements. We anticipate that this bidding process will occur in the fall of 2018. There's a chance that utility relocations will also occur in late 2018. However, we anticipate that most of the road construction will occur during the calendar year 2019. It should be noted that this is our anticipated schedule for today, but because we're still in the preliminary stages, this is subject to change. Comments that we received tonight, comments that we received throughout the public comment period, can alter that decision-making process, and the schedule may be adjusted to incorporate these revisions. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Monica, who will discuss the environmental evaluation.
Which is considered a federal action, due to the federal money that has been allocated, the Federal Highway Administration determined the appropriate level of documentation with an environmental assessment. The environmental assessment prepared for this project, which again is available here tonight for review, was released for public involvement by the Indiana Department of Transportation and the Federal Highway Administration on May 2nd. For the natural environment, some of the things we looked into were wetlands and waterways, threatened endangered species, and floodplains. However, none of these resources were determined to be impacted by the proposed project. And this was done through field investigations in coordination with the appropriate resource agencies. For the human environment, we looked at potential cultural features, including properties and archaeological sites that were listed or could be considered eligible on the National Register of Historic Places. No such resources were identified within the area of potential effect, and a finding of no historic properties affected was issued for the project by the Indiana Department of Transportation on behalf of the Federal Highway Administration. We also looked at potential hazardous materials that could affect the project. One site, a former gas station at State Road 38 and Lincoln Street, was identified. However, it was concluded that no further investigations of the site were warranted because the contamination plume had been delineated to an area about 250 to 300 feet away from the project's right-of-way. The documented flow pattern of groundwater was primarily away from the proposed construction limits. Social and community impacts that were also considered for the project. This project crosses the green space between Edgewater and Lake Point apartment complexes. So some of the things we worked to identify were whether there were cohesive characteristics between these two communities and what functions the green space served to residents. Through our outreach and the public information meeting, the distribution of surveys, in an open house, we were able to determine that these two apartment complexes do not share any cohesive characteristics. And the green space was primarily used for children to play and for residents to walk their pets. However, the improved community connectivity through the multi-use path that would improve not only those two communities, but communities further to the west, was found to in part offset these negative impacts. In addition, it was found through the surveys that were returned to us that a majority of the residents do not currently use that green space and identified that they could use other green space within the apartment complexes. So another social impact that is associated is changes in access to businesses that would result from the removal of drives or the installation of a raised median. Such would be the case for Burger King, Tractor Supply, and Main Source. While patrons and employees will be inconvenienced from the changes, such impacts are mostly temporary because there's an ability to adjust to the new circulation pattern over time. Another human factor that we looked at was noise. A detailed analysis was done for this project. As a result of the analysis, we took into account the existing noise conditions, the future noise conditions 20 years out without this project being built, and we also looked at future noise 20 years if this project is built. A total of 142 receptors were included in the analysis, and some of the things that would cause impacts, there's a substantially impacted receptor, which is one where the predicted noise levels 20 years out from construction either approaches or exceeds the Federal Highway Administration's noise abatement criteria, referred to as NAC. In addition, a receptor can be considered substantially impacted if the predicted noise 20 years from construction is determined to be 15 decibels or more over the existing noise levels today. The result of the noise analysis found that none of the receptors analyzed approached or exceeded the NAC, and that none were substantially impacted. And we have a map over on the side summarizing the results of our noise analysis. So based on the data from the U.S. Census Bureau, we found that our project is located within an elevated low-income and minority population. An aging analysis was completed to determine if there were disproportionately high and adverse impacts, and if so, to seek ways to offset or avoid them. The outreach efforts that were undertaken have already been discussed, but the information we gathered was used to finalize an environmental justice analysis. The results of this analysis indicated the affected communities will be burdened by increased noise levels, decreased air quality, the loss of green space, potential for hazardous materials haulers to use this route, and then temporary disruptions during construction. While the project is anticipated to have adverse impacts, the impacts are not considered disproportionately high when you factor in some of the benefits that these communities will receive. So the benefits will include enhanced access to downtown Greensburg, there will be improved pedestrian facilities, and there will be opportunities for future goods and services to come into that area. Based off of the comments that we received from return surveys from the residents of Edgewater and Lakepoint apartment complexes, lighting and benches were two things that were recommended to improve this project. So, as Patrick discussed, lighting is already a part of the project and will be consistent with the first phase of Veterans Way. However, benches are proposed to be added along the south side, along the multi-use path, and the number of benches and the exact locations will be determined during final design. Okay, so now towards the land acquisition phase. There's a blue pamphlet on the back table, and it's entitled Acquisition, Acquiring Real Property for Federal and Federal Aid Programs and Projects. And this addresses the subject of right-of-way. This document explains the process of buying property required for federal projects. Copies of the pamphlet are available here, and I will note that the preliminary plans, they show approximately 5.7 acres of new permanent right-of-way and 1.5 acres of temporary right-of-way. And this will be from 8 different parcels. There are also copies of a pamphlet titled Relocation, Your Rights and Benefits as a Displaced Person under the Federal Relocation Assistance Program. This is the green brochure on the back table if you're interested. And this document explains the process and your rights as a relocatee. The proposed project has two impacts to structures, the first of which is the Edgewater Apartment Leasing Office, which will be relocated, and the other is a small agricultural outstructure. So please take as many copies of both of these pamphlets as you need. All right-of-way purchased for this project will comply with the Uniform Act of 1970, which requires all federal, state, and local governments to offer just compensation for any acquisition. When this project advances to the right-of-way acquisition stage, the land acquisition process would begin with the abstracting of each parcel to determine the legal owners and identify the apparent property boundaries. Final right-of-way engineering and right-of-way plans are then forwarded to the appraisers. Each parcel is inspected and appraised by a qualified appraiser to determine the fair market value. An offer to purchase is then negotiated with the owner. The appraising and negotiating phase of the right-of-way process will not start until after the approval of the environmental document. The compensation offer is not allowed to be less than the fair market value of the property. In case of partial acquisitions, the city will indicate in writing the amount that is to be paid for the portion of the property acquired for the project. Then a separate amount will be paid for damages to the portion that you would retain. Should the remaining land have little or no value, the city will consider purchasing it as excess land. Once an agreement is reached between the city and the owner will be asked to sign an acceptance offer and the deed of transfer. Property owners will have 30 days from receipt of the offer to either accept or reject it. If accepted, payment should be expected within 90 days from receipt of the signed acceptance offer. Should no agreement on compensation be reached, mediation will be pursued as a way to seek a mutually agreed upon amount. If mediation fails, condemnation proceedings on the property may be advanced. Again, we are here tonight to solicit your comments on the proposed project for part of the environmental process. The deadline for comments is June 7th. We have also provided information packets for your use. Later, if you decide you need additional copies of this information, you can call or email me at the information found in the packet, and I will send you additional copies. As stated earlier, the next step in the development process will be to finalize the environmental document, which will include Federal Highway Administration's decision document, likely to be a finding of no significant impact. That decision document will include the response to all comments and questions received as part of this public hearing. When this document is approved by the Indiana Department of Transportation and the Federal Highway Administration, a notice of availability will be mailed to those who have signed into any of the public meetings or who submitted a comment regarding the project. And also anyone who signed in here tonight, so make sure you sign in. All right, so we'd like to thank everyone for their attendance this evening and remind you the written comments can be dropped off in the box in the back. And we will now invite those of you who signed up to speak to come forward. And we'll go in the order. Okay, so no one signed up on the sheet. So if anyone would like to make a comment, the floor is now open. Mail them in later, and our project team will all be available.